Start with the Russians. Ukraine's a pretty big country. This is not a small piece of turf. And the probability of Russia achieving its strategic objectives of conquering Ukraine, of overrunning Ukraine, the probability of that happening is close to zero. I suppose theoretically it's possible, maybe, I guess, but I don't see it happening militarily. So I just don't see that happening. But they do currently occupy about 20% of that of Ukraine. So they occupy a piece of ground that's about 900 kilometers long, and I don't know, probably about 75 or 80 kilometers deep. So it's not a small piece of ground. And they invaded this country with upwards of 170,000, 180,000 troops in multiple field armies, combined arms armies. And they have suffered a tremendous amount of casualties, but he's also done this mobilization and called up additional people. So the Russians have reinforced, and they still have significant Russian combat power inside Ukraine. Now, Ukraine's had great success in the defense. They did a tremendous job in defeating the Russian offensive. It's incredible what they were able to do. And then they went on the offensive at the beginning of September. And they had great success up in Kharkiv, and they've had better success even down in Kherson, as you just witnessed. But Kherson and Kharkiv, physically, geographically, are relatively small compared to the whole. So that the military task of militarily kicking the Russians physically out of Ukraine is a very difficult task. And it's not going to happen the next couple of weeks unless the Russian army completely collapses, which is unlikely. So in terms of probability, the probability of a Ukrainian military victory defined as kicking the Russians out of all of Ukraine, to include what they define or what they claim is Crimea, to the probability of that happening anytime soon is not high, militarily. Politically, there may be a political solution where politically the Russians withdraw. That's possible. You want to negotiate from a position of strength. Russia right now is on its back. The Russian military is suffering tremendously. Leaders have been, their leadership is really hurting bad. They've lost a lot of casualties, killed and wounded. They've lost, I won't go over exact numbers because they're classified, but they've lost a tremendous amount of their tanks and their infantry fighting vehicles. They've lost a lot of their fourth and fifth generation fighters and helicopters and so on and so forth. The Russian military is really hurting bad. So you want to negotiate at a time when you're at your strength and your opponent is at weakness. And it's possible, maybe, that there'll be a political solution. All I'm saying is there's a possibility for it. That's all I'm saying.
Top U.S. General Mark Milley says it is not likely that Ukraine will achieve an outright military victory against Russia. That is very significant. He went on to say they may have the upper hand, meaning Ukraine, in potential negotiations, though, because of recent wins in the battlefield. Listen.
The probability of a Ukrainian military victory defined as kicking the Russians out of all of Ukraine, to include what they define or what they claim is Crimea, to the probability of that happening anytime soon is not high. There may be a political solution where politically the Russians withdraw. That's possible.
So that push for diplomacy is not in line with the Biden administration's stance. Kylie Atwood joins us now. How unaligned then are they?
Well, what's interesting here is that the chairman of the Joint Chief of Staff made similar comments last week, Poppy, where he encouraged publicly that the Ukrainians should be seizing diplomacy at this moment, because he said when there's an opportunity, they should seize it. But then you have National Security Advisor Jake Sullivan, who said, no, when he was asked about this in recent days. He said the position of the Biden administration is that the United States is going to strengthen Ukraine's hand in the war, and then they will seek diplomacy. They will seek a political solution when they want to. The United States isn't going to make that determination for them. So it's pretty striking that Milley came out just yesterday and sort of doubled down on what he said, even though it doesn't match the approach of the Biden administration at large here. And we should note that it has sent some Ukrainians with questions as to who to listen to in the Biden administration, even though President Biden himself has been very clear in saying the Ukrainians are going to dictate any political solution here, any diplomatic solution here. There are questions when you have the top U.S. general saying that maybe this is the moment for diplomacy.
You certainly do. Before you go, Kylie, you have some new reporting of your own on what happened behind the scenes as information on that missile landed in Poland. What happened?
Yeah, so when the missile landed, President Biden was in Bali. It was 4 a.m. when the Secretary of State was woken in his hotel room with an aide knocking on his door and telling him what had happened. He immediately went into President Biden's room where the Secretary of State, the National Security Advisor, Jake Sullivan, and the president really huddled around and together collected all of the incoming information. In a way, it's kind of beneficial that they were all together in a hotel, even though this was a circumstance that everyone was fearing could happen. And as they went through that information, President Biden called the Polish president, and his national security advisor and the Secretary of State were in there for that phone call. And then the national security advisor made phone calls to the Ukrainians, essentially urging them not to get too far ahead, because they said that this was a Russian missile. We now know it's unlikely that that's the case. It was likely an accidental Ukrainian defensive missile. And so there was a number of phone conversations that were happening in that hotel room at the time as the national security team was trying to go through and figure out what was going on here.
Yeah, and if this was purposeful, for sure. Kylie Atwood, thank you for the great reporting.
Here in Ghana, when it comes to chicken, the good old days are back. Why? Because Boris B's Chicken, BBC, is here. Yep, give your family and loved ones Boris B's Chicken. Fresh, tasty, delicious. Boris B's Chicken is produced right here in Ghana by our cherished poultry farmers with support from the Ministry of Agric. Get whole frozen chicken, gizzard, chicken feet, chicken neck, and chicken liver for those special family meals, buffets, picnics, funerals, and all restaurants. Get Boris B's Chicken. It's halal, so everybody can enjoy. Wherever you are, call Boris B's Farms hotline 05444453. Ask for our branch that is closest to you and come get your chicken. Boris B's Chicken, BBC, proudly a Fiakoko.